Hey student, this is Dr. Dalvi. Today we'll have a second lecture in this lecture series in books of biochemistry. Yesterday we have seen the first lecture in the third unit of your course, that is ketone body metabolism. In that we have studied how the ketone bodies, they are synthesized in the body and they are utilized. Now, before going to this next lecture, I have to tell you that these lectures are very important as far as the examination is concerned, because after every lecture I am going to tell you regarding the important aspects or important questions which are generally asked in the university exam, and particularly MCQs and short notes which are asked related to the topics. So that will be helpful you for the examination, for preparation of examination also, and for understanding the topic. I have tried to cover this particular syllabus per lecture for 15, 20 or 25 minutes, so that you can understand the topic properly, and each topic is connected with the previous topic, so that you have to watch each and every lecture. So please watch first yesterday's lecture on the ketone body metabolism, so that you can understand the today's lecture. And if you have understood the lecture, please do not forget to hit the like button. And if you have got any difficulties, you can approach me, or you can email me, you can phone me at any time, so that we can, or I can solve your problems. Now, today's before going to today's lecture, yesterday what we have seen, that briefly we will cover. First, we have seen that who the ketone bodies synthesize and metabolize, that is ketone body metabolism. So in this, the important questions which are generally asked in university examinations, like a short note on ketone body biosynthesis, okay, then how the ketone bodies, they are utilized by the extrahepatic tissues, then the MCQs, like most important questions, like which is a rate limiting enzyme, rate limiting reactions in the ketone body synthesis, then which are the true ketone bodies, isn't it? So like that, or we can say how the utilization of the ketone bodies takes place, which enzyme which is responsible or absent in liver, so that liver and RBCs, why they cannot synthesize the ketone bodies. So these are the some important questions which are asked in the university examination. So please take a note of that, and you watch each and every lectures henceforth. So last lecture, that is ketone body metabolism, some part I have to add in that. One thing is that when the ketone bodies, they are metabolism based, they are used as a fuel source by the extrahepatic tissue. What is the how many ATPs they are generated? So if you see in the ketone body metabolism, when the beta-hydroxybutyrate is metabolized or oxidized by the extrahepatic tissue, how many ketone bodies they are generated? So this is a question generally asked. So how many ATPs they are generated? So as you know, the ketone bodies, they are formed or when they are oxidized, the two molecule of acetyl coenzyme A, they are formed, two molecules of acetyl coenzyme, and this acetyl coenzyme A, when enters into TCA cycle or oxidized in a TCA cycle further, each molecule of acetyl coenzyme, as you know, so it gives 10 molecules of ATPs. So two molecules will give the 20 molecules of ATP. Right? Then next thing is that when beta hydroxybutyrate, it is oxidized to acetoacetate. Last in oxidation, or you can say utilization of ketone bodies, we have seen yesterday, when beta hydroxybutyrate is oxidized to acetoacetate, it will generate NADH plus H plus. So this NADH plus H plus, when it enters into, or when it oxidizes into electron transport chain, it goes, it will give the 2.5 ATPs. Correct. Now this, so the total ATPs they are generated by the two molecule of acetyl coenzyme A or beta hydroxybutyrate, when it is oxidized, it will give the 22.5 ATPs. But here there is a one ATP expenditure in the process. When succinyl coenzyme A is converted to succinate in the TCA cycle, when it gives one ATP in TCA cycle, that ATP is used here, or one molecule of ATP it is used, so it will give net production of ATP when one molecule of beta hydroxybutyrate is oxidized, will give the 21.5 ATPs. So this is the answer. So when the question is asked about how many molecules of beta ATPs are formed when beta hydroxybutyrate is oxidized, so as a ketone bodies, when the net ATP production is 21.5. Okay, but if the question is as how many ATPs they are generated by oxidation of one molecule of acetoacetate, then here the answer is 19.5, because here the NADH or H plus it is not formed when the aceto beta hydroxybutyrate it is converted into acetoacetate. So directly when acetoacetate it is oxidized, it will give 19.5 ATPs. Okay, so this is the most important things, and these are the questions which are asked generally in a university examination: how many ATPs are generated by one molecule acetoacetate, and how many are generated by one molecule of beta hydroxybutyrate. So these are the things you should remember for this particular lecture. Now coming to next topic, that is diabetic ketoacidosis. Now what is ketoacidosis, or what is ketosis? So we have seen the how the keto bodies are formed, and what is the normal concentration of ketone bodies in the body or in the blood. It is less than 1 milligram per dl. Okay, so that is the normal concentration of ketone bodies. Now this concentration in increase above 1 milligram, so generally it is more than 100 milligram or 200, it will increase eventually depending on the clinical condition. So this is called ketosis, ketonemia. When there is increase in the ketone bodies, it is called the ketonemia, increase in the ketone bodies in the blood. Now because of increase in the ketone bodies in the blood, there is a excretion of ketone bodies in the urine. This is called as a ketonuria. And these two conditions, along with the ketonemia and ketonuria, called as a ketosis. Now diabetic ketoacidosis, is a condition related with the clinic, or is a clinical condition related with the diabetes mellitus. Particularly uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, uncontrolled. And also or basically because of type 1 of diabetes mellitus. So in diabetes mellitus, this detail we will study in subsequent lecture, but here the diabetic ketoacidosis, because of the clinical condition diabetes mellitus or uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, where there is a ketonemia that increases ketone bodies in the blood and increase ketone or excretion of ketone bodies in the urine, that is ketosis. Now generally it is called a DKA, diabetic ketoacidosis. So we'll study this, what is diabetes ketoacidosis and what are the consequences of diabetes ketoacidosis and what is, how you can treat it. Okay, so to understand this, we should know about the hormone which are related with the diabetes or diabetic mellitus. So most important hormone, as you know, it is insulin. What? So insulin is maintains the glucose level, or whenever there is a increase in the level of blood glucose level, which we call as a hyperglycemia, which is stimulus for secretion of insulin. Now what is the insulin? Is an anabolic hormone. So what is the effect of insulin on the body? It causes building of the molecules, building all the molecules, that is the building of the carbohydrate, that means glucose is converted into glycogen, that is plus a glycogenesis, then lipids, they are the fatty acids which are converted into lipid and store, that is called as a lipid synthesis, isn't it? And protein synthesis. So these are the three important molecules which are excess in the blood after post absorptive state, after you taking food, when this level of fatty acid or you can say glucose and protein, amino acids, they are increased in the blood, these are diverted towards the for the storing as an energy source, and they are also utilized by the body for the energy. Now suppose in relation to ketone, or can say the ketoacidosis, diabetic ketoacidosis, most important thing is the fat, because as you know, the ketoacidosis occurs because of the excess breakdown of the fat or beta oxidation of fatty acid, where the excess breakdown of fat and acetyl coenzyme which is formed, and because of the excess acetyl coenzyme A and the TCA cycle is saturated, this acetyl coenzyme A is diverted for the synthesis of ketone bodies, which is the acts as a main fuel for the extrahepatic tissue, particularly brain muscle or the cardiac muscle and any other tissues of the body. So if you consider the adipose tissue, here you have adipose tissue here, so this is adipose tissue, and you have a nucleus, and adipose tissue, as you know, contain the fatty acids or triacylglycerol. These are the fatty acids or triacylglycerol, fatty acids and glycerol, TAG, triacylglycerol we are saying. Now under the influence of insulin, normally what happen, this synthesis of triacylglycerol occurs, because fatty acids, they are form with the glycerol molecule, they form the triacylglycerol and they are stored as an energy source, isn't it? So this is in the influence of insulin. When there is a less insulin is secreted, that is the condition called diabetes mellitus. So when there is an insufficient insulin, what will happen? The other hormone, that is a glucagon, when there is a energy source is less, or glucose level, the glucose cannot utilize by the body properly, so there is a secretion of glucagon, that means the insulin glucagon ratio will decrease, and that is leads to breakdown of this triacylglycerol, that is called as lipolysis. Okay, so this lipolysis results into increased free fatty acids in the blood. What? Now these free fatty acids in the blood, increased level of free acids in the blood, they are diverted, carried to the most important part of the body or organ, that is liver. What? So in liver, these free fatty acids, they are taken and thus results into increased synthesis of ketone bodies. Got? Now these ketone bodies, they are again, they are carried to the blood, ketone bodies, and their level increases in the blood. So this is because of the insufficient insulin, condition called as diabetes mellitus, and because of that is a lipolysis, and that results into increase in the ketone bodies. This we call as a ketonemia. Okay, so when there is increase in the blood, as already I told you, when the ketone bodies level they are increased, the kidney threshold for the ketone bodies, when it cross the kidney threshold, they appears in the another important organ or excreted via, you can say, kidney. So this is excretion, that is called ketonuria. What? So these are the things what happen when there is a insulin deficiency, the clinical condition like diabetes mellitus, or you can say during starvation also, whenever there is insufficient energy, fasting, starvation, and diabetes mellitus is a clinical condition. This type of things occurs when the fat, their excessive breakdown of fat, oxidation of fat results into ketosis. So this is the way the ketone bodies, they are synthesized by the liver, and they are, the ketone bodies are acids, isn't it? These are beta hydroxybutyric acid, acetoacetic acid. These are the main ketone bodies which are acidic, and they are going to, they results into condition called acidosis. So acidosis, that is the main condition, that is a decrease in the pH of the blood, and this is most dangerous condition, and most of the time death of the diabetic complication or diabetes occur because of the, it is called as diabetic ketoacidosis, because of the is acidosis. Now this, what happened because of this acidosis, which is the decrease in the pH, which is detected by the respiratory center, in the brain. And that results into hyperventilation. That is a compensatory mechanism for, isn't it, in acidosis. So that results in hyperventilation, and also there is a peripheral vasodilatation. So because of the peripheral vasodilatation, what happened? There is a hypothermia, decrease in the body temperature, and that results into decrease in or blood pressure, decrease in the blood pressure, low BP. So these are the consequences. What will happen? There is most important acidosis, and because of acidosis, there is a, as you know, the blood pH is very critical. It should be maintained in the normal range. Then a slight decrease or increase in the blood pH is very dangerous, or you can say that the body enzyme system, neuromuscular transmission, this cannot be takes place. If there is a slight change in the blood pressure, you can say acidosis. So these are the consequences. First important thing is acidosis, and because of acidosis, there is a वैसोडायलेटेशन, हाइपोथर्मिया इजंट इट, एंड हाइपर वेंटिलेशन टू मेंटेन द मैकेनिज्म फॉर द मेंटेनेंस ऑफ द एसिड बेस बैलेंस. ओके, सो दिस इज वन कॉन्सिक्वेंस. नाउ आफ्टर दैट द वॉट आर द अदर कॉन्सिक्वेंसेस ऑफ डायबिटीज मेलेटस और केटोएसिडोसिस. नाउ फर्स्ट इज बिकॉज ऑफ द इफ द पेशेंट इज हाइपर ग्लाइसेमिक इजंट इट ड्यू टू लैक ऑफ इंसुलिन, दैट इज अ हाइपर ग्लाइसेमिया. सो हाइपर ग्लाइसेमिया इज बिकॉज ऑफ डेफिशियंसी ऑफ इंसुलिन. गॉट? सो दिस हाइपर ग्लाइसेमिया results into glycosuria. Hyperglycemia results into glycosuria. Why there is a glycosuria? Because as we have seen, the ketonuria, when the renal threshold for when the ketone bodies level of ketone cross the renal threshold, same way when the glucose, blood glucose cross level, cross the renal threshold, it appears in the urine. It is called as a glycosuria. Okay, so this glycosuria results into osmotic diuresis. So there is a, because of increase in the blood sugar level, there is a frequent, you can say the polyuria, you can say the polyuria condition. Now this polyuria is because of presence of sugar in the urine, because sugar, as you know, is increase the osmotic pressure of the urine, and it, because of that, it draws lot of water. So we are saying that the glucose molecule always draws water from, isn't it, from the tissue, because of increase in osmotic pressure in the tubular kidney tubules. So a lot of this thing, the fluid is thrown output, that is thrown out, and that is results into osmotic diuresis. And when there is a polyuria, because of the osmotic diuresis, that results into hypovolemia. That means the blood volume decreases, that is called a dehydration. Blood water fluid volume decreases, and that is dehydration results. Okay, so that is most important consequence of in diabetic ketoacidosis. There is a acidosis along with there is a hypovolemia, that is a loss of fluid, and that results into dehydration. Okay, so because of this hypovolemia, there is a hypotension which results, that is decrease in the blood pressure, and that results into shock and death if it is not treated. So these are the consequence of hyperglycemia in diabetes mellitus or in diabetic ketoacidosis. So death is a consequence if not treated. Okay, now one thing, another thing is that there is a disturbance in electrolyte balance, or you can say electrolyte imbalance we are saying. So because of the osmotic diuresis, what happened, there is a loss of potassium ions in the urine. Hypokalemia, you can say the hypokalemia, that is loss of potassium ions and so results into hypo. So this is very important. Electrolyte imbalance also takes place. So water imbalance, then acid base imbalance and electrolyte imbalance. These are the most important, you can say, consequences of diabetic ketoacidosis or acidosis in because of the diabetes mellitus or other clinical conditions. Now this hypokalemia can cause because of reduction in the calcium levels, potassium ion level in the blood. This results into, may result into cardiac arrest. And consequently, death. So these are the most important, you can say, consequences of diabetic ketoacidosis. But now, what are the important guidelines for treatment in this case? If you see, if you have understood all these things, then you can save the life of animal or patient by treatment at a particular point. Now what are the treatment guidelines for this? Most important thing is that first you have to monitor electrolytes. As you know, there is a electrolyte disturbances, so here you have to monitor the, in a hypokalemia it is there, so monitor the electrolytes and treat this with some electrolytes as per the requirement. Okay, second is to, as the root of this particular condition or disorder is because of the lack of insulin, isn't it? So if it is the uncontrolled diabetes mellitus where the insulin is type 1 or type 2 diabetes, so you have to treat this patient with the insulin injection. So give insulin after monitoring the blood sugar level. Okay, so then if you see here on this how the consequences of whatever we have studied, there is a hypovolemia, dehydration, electrolyte imbalance. So here hypovolemia or fluid loss in the body because of the polyuria or because of the acidosis. So in that case, you have to treat this patient with the fluid therapy to maintain the water balance. So to keep this water for disturbance in the electrolyte and water balance, you give the fluid therapy. And fourth is, we have seen that there is a because of the vasodilatation, there is a the hypothermia, so that we can improve, or we can improve by keeping the patient warm. So this is the treatment guideline where on the basis of this course of this particular diabetic ketoacidosis, you can go for the treatment guidelines. So this is about the diabetic ketoacidosis. So please go through this video properly. If you have got any doubt, please do not hesitate to call me, or you can also email me, or you can send a WhatsApp message. And if you have understood this, please press the like button on the this YouTube channel. And if you have understood it properly,